بسم الله والحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وبعد. We're still looking at Surah Al-Fatiha, but since yesterday we brought up the issue of dua, we're just going to spend a little bit more time on the topic of dua, especially since we are now in the month of Ramadan. So of course, Surah Al-Fatiha, we said, أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين الرحمن الرحيم مالك يوم الدين إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين. We got up to this part, and then we said the ayah that comes after this is إهدينا الصراط المستقيم. And everything that comes before إهدينا الصراط المستقيم is praise and glorification of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we said that this is one of the adab, or one of the etiquettes of dua, which is to prelude the dua with praise and with glorification of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we mentioned some of the evidence for that. We should also look to the Quran to find out how to make dua. As I said, in Surah Al-Fatiha, we have this wonderful adab, this wonderful etiquette or manner, and that is praising and glorifying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala before dua. I also alluded to what Zakariya alayhi salam did, as we find in Surah Maryam. Zakariya alayhi salam, in his prelude or in his introduction, if you will, to dua, before actually calling upon Allah and asking Him directly, then he began by showing his great need for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So he says, Rabbi inni wahana al-azmu minni washta'ala ar-ra'su shayba. So he's showing that he is weak. He's showing that he is in need of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. My Lord, my bones are brittle. My hair is all white. I fear that my relatives after me will not establish the religion. So he shows Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala his great need before actually asking of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In any event, what we need to be very clear on is that each and every one of us are in need of Allah Jalla wa Ala, and we cannot do without Him for any of our affairs. As far as dua is concerned, and that means calling upon Allah, begging Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, asking Him for all our needs, then know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala never tires of us asking Him. As a matter of fact, you know, if you look at the people, what are you going to find? If you go to people and ask too much, if you're persistent in asking, if you ask regularly, then people get upset with you, right? Because nobody wants, you know, others to come and constantly ask and beg and so on and so forth. They get tired of hearing that and of having to give. However, with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we learn from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that he, that is Allah jalla wa ala, gets angry when we don't ask of him. Allah Jalla wa Ala gets angry when we don't ask of Him. As a matter of fact, He subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us in the Quran, Udu'uni astajib lakum. Call upon me and I shall respond to you. Then if we look to the Hadith Qudsi, in which Allah, we are informed that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala descends to the last heaven, of course, in a manner that befits His majesty. We know that He descends to the last heaven. How this happens, the last third of the night, it's the last third of the night here, but it's daytime elsewhere. All of those details don't matter to us. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is different from His creation. Allah jalla wa ala controls His creation. All of those details do not matter to us. What matters to us, that we have been told by the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, الَّذِي لَا يَنْطِقُ عَنِ الْهَوَىٰ إِنْ هُوَ إِلَّا وَحْيٌ يُوحَىٰ. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, who does not speak from his own desires, but rather it is divine revelation which has been revealed to him. The Prophet alayhi salatu wa sallam informed us that this is the case with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala each and every night during the last third of the night. Now, when Allah jalla wa ala descends to the last heaven in a manner that befits His Majesty subhanahu wa ta'ala, you know that He's calling out to us. He says, for example, مَنْ ذَا الَّذِي يَدْعُونِي فَأَسْتَجِيبُ لَهُ. Who is it that will call upon me so that I can respond to him? مَنْ ذَا الَّذِي يَسْأَلُنِي فَأُعْطِيَهُ. Who is it that is going to ask me so I can give them? And you know, when I say give him, or of course it includes her. I mean, we're all grown up enough to understand that. مَنْ ذَا الَّذِي يَسْتَغْفِرُنِي فَأَغْفِرَ لَهُ. Or فَأَغْفِرُ لَهُ. Who is it that will seek my forgiveness so that I can forgive them? And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us, أُجِيبُ دَعْوَةَ الدَّاعِ إِذَا دَعَانْ فَلْيَسْتَجِيبُوا لِي. Right? So He tells us that He will respond, أُجِيبُ دَعْوَة, to the call of the one who calls upon Him. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us that He will answer, that He will answer our dua. So never be, number one, never be too proud to ask of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And never be shy to ask of Allah jalla wa ala. And never think that there is anything that is too difficult for Allah. Don't say that, but my issue is way too big. My issue is too complicated. Remember that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is all powerful. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is Rabbul Alameen. Remember we said that at the beginning, Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the owner, the possessor, the controller. He manages the affairs of all things subhanahu wa ta'ala. So whatever it is that you and I need, don't think that it is too big, nor should you think that it is too small. Whatever it is that you and I need, let's ask of Him, but let's ask of Him with sincerity. Let's be persistent in asking as well. Let's ask of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala while we are confident that He subhanahu wa ta'ala will respond to us. Alright, so these things are extremely, extremely important. So what is it that is bothering you? An illness that you have, an illness that one of your siblings has, an illness that one of your children has, an illness that a relative or a friend or a parent has, whatever it may be. Is it that you're not able to get married, you're past a certain age where in your society nobody bothers with women like that, or nobody will bother marrying their daughters to a man who is of that age? Don't worry about it. Everything is within the ability of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What is it that you're having a problem with? Is it that you have a problem with your children? Do you have a problem with your parents? Are you having a problem with your spouse? All of these things, ask of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. يَسْأَلُهُ مَنْ فِي السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ. Everything is dependent upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And everything asks of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, including the animals. So you and I, we should ask of Him, tabaraka wa ta'ala, and we should be persistent in our dua. Don't just ask once and give up. No, do not do that. Continually ask. It doesn't matter for how long. And know and rest assured that every time you raise your hands and ask of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, every time you shed tears and you ask of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when you acknowledge that you are weak before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and you acknowledge that you are in need of Him, and you show Him that you are begging because you are incapable while He, tabaraka wa ta'ala, is capable, then rest assured that you are being rewarded for that, even if your dua is not being accepted then and there, because الدعاء هو العبادة. Dua is ibadah. Dua is worship. Alright? So, ask of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and you know what? You will be responded to. Allah jalla wa ala, if He doesn't grant you what you want in this world, He will grant it to you in the hereafter. So, it's a win-win situation. Plus, on top of that, you will be rewarded for asking of Him, because that in and of itself is an act of worship. And remember also that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants us to beg of Him and to ask of Him. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us, as we find in the Hadith Qudsi, that look, ask for everything. You know, all of you are hungry. So seek sustenance from me, that is your food, and I will feed you. All of you are naked, so seek clothing from me. I need the means to be clothed, and I will clothe you. All of you are astray. Okay? So seek guidance, and I shall guide you. So everything that we look at in the Quran, in the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, we see that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants us to ask of Him. He never tires. And if all of us, as again we find in the Hadith Qudsi, if everyone from the first person to the last person to ever live, if everyone from mankind and jinn, all right, if everyone were to gather on one plane and ask of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and Allah jalla wa ala was to give everyone whatever they requested and whatever they asked for, then this would not decrease what is with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. No more than if you were to stick a needle in the ocean and take it out. How much did that decrease from the water of the ocean? Nothing. So if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala were to give everyone whatever they asked for, it would not decrease what is with Him in any way, shape or form. So do not diminish the importance and the power of a dua. Alright, and with that, I remind myself and the rest of you that we are in the month of Ramadan, and this also is a month of dua. And do not forget that, when you wake up for the suhoor, that is in the last third of the night. So that is a time for dua as well. And don't forget that when you are about to break your fast, then this is also a time when dua is readily accepted from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And with that, we conclude today. And I beg of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to accept from us our fasting, to accept from us all the different types of worship that we carry out for Him during this month. And I beg of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to accept from us our night prayers, and as I said, all our acts of worship. Hada wallahu a'lam, wa sallallahu wa sallam ala nabiyyina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.